Good evening and happy Sabbath. Welcome to the Conscience and Justice Council Black History Celebration. We are so excited to have each and every one of you participating with us again. We have an all-star cast, a dynamic cast, and special guests that we're just happy that are going to be a part of this broadcast. The Conscience and Justice Council, you just saw a little bit of information, is comprised of public affairs and religious liberty directors across the United States, along with experts, and we believe in the biblical foundation for conscience and justice. We are happy to see each and every one of you out this evening. We appreciate you engaging with us. And before we get started, we just want to have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you. We love you. We lift you up. And Lord, we are excited about the program and the guests that we have this evening. We ask, oh God, as a result of this presentation, that we'll be drawn closer to you and understand the mission of why we are here to serve in this great plan of salvation that you've already provided. Bless us individually and collectively, and we'll be mindful and careful in giving you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. In the worthy and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I am excited because we have one of Adventist's premier scholars with us this evening, and he is a beast in his own right. He has a PhD that he has. He's not pile high and deep, but he is steeped in knowledge and history, especially as it relates to Black Seventh-day Adventist history. Not only does he have his own website, but he is a research par excellence. If you ever want to get into a deep discussion about our history, the man you need to find, the man for the time, is none other than Dr. Benjamin Baker, who holds a PhD from Howard University, a graduate of Oakwood University, and just an all-around scholar who can be practical and break it down like none other. So when you think of the pantheon of Adventist historical writers, Dr. Calvin B. Rock, Dr. Samuel London, Douglas Morgan. We have to put on that mantle none other than Dr. Benjamin Baker. Dr. Baker, welcome to the broadcast. We're happy to have you at this time.
Thank you for having me, Elder Woods. I appreciate it. When you were introducing me, I was looking around to see who you were talking about.
Well, hey, when you're that distinguished, there's no need to look. We just say, thank God, thank God, thank God. Without further ado, Dr. Baker, we'll turn this program over to you.
Thank you once again to Elder Woods and the CJC. It's my pleasure to be with you. Elder Woods, is my PowerPoint showing now? I want to make sure that my PowerPoint is showing. There we go. Hopefully you all can see it. Before I begin, I always want to encourage everyone that this is not just me talking. When we talk about Adventist history, it is something that all of us do together. We do history in community. We depend upon you to do history. So the talk that I will give tonight is really cobbled together from bits of history that have survived from other people. So even now, you provide the stuff of history that historians and others do history from. And so I want to encourage everyone listening to please preserve and digitize your photos, your documents, manuscripts, letters, and put them in the cloud, put them on hard drives, send them to others, because these are what we use to do history. As you can see here on the screen is blacksdahistory.org, blacksdahistory.org, which is your website. This website belongs to you. I want to encourage all of you to visit and interact with it. It is commemorating its 10th anniversary. So I'm very proud of that. And for its 10th anniversary, it just got a facelift. So, and the Lord really blessed because I actually designed it and put it together. So you know the Lord was working on that one because I have no web skills. So the Holy Spirit, the great web designer, I think helped me with it. But of course, any flaws you see are mine. Please go on the website and interact with it. If you see something missing, if you want to add material, just contact us and let us know. So I want to encourage all of you to go check out the new website and the accompanying YouTube channel. And that's Black SDA History on YouTube. We have about 205 videos. And let me tell you this, most people really, it's a go-to site on Sabbath, okay? Good Sabbath viewing. It should be ad-free. No ads on there. Because we do this out of love, no money. We do this out of love. And so this is people's go-to site on the Sabbath. But you can use it for schools. You can use it for church programs, personal edification, entertainment. Please be sure to look at our YouTube channel. We just uploaded two of the oldest extant Adventist recordings in existence. And I'll let you know that those recordings are from a Black Adventist choir, probably from Atlanta, Georgia. One is from 1913. One is believed to be from 1926. And this is a Black Adventist choir, and it's on a 26 RPPM record. It's a race record, if you know what that term means. It's a race record, and they're singing Negro spirituals. So this is from 1913 and 1926. Please check those out. As usual, during Black History Month, there is a great spike in the views of the YouTube channel. We have, what are some of the popular ones? Barack Obama and Seventh-day Adventists, 100 famous Black Seventh-day Adventists, information about Ellen G. White and Blacks. We have it all on there. So please be sure to check that out. My brief talk is going to draw on some of the books you see here. I always want to leave it open for further research. So I want to encourage you to pick up this new book, Hot Off the Press, by Dr. Douglas Morgan, one of my esteemed colleagues. It's called Change Agents. And it is on the 1943 committee that I will speak about. A book that came out about 3 years ago was Protest and Progress by, of course, the august Calvin B. Rock. Be sure to pick that up. And then there is Out of the Trash Came Truth, which was written by Dr. Frank Hale Jr. And that is really a chapter of his autobiography, Angels Watching Over Me. But it is also a standalone book. So please be sure to go out and pick up those books. I guess go in, get on Amazon and pick up those books. I'm going to be comparing, Elder Woods asked me to compare the 1943 committee, I'm going to call it. It's the Committee for the Advancement of the Progress of Colored Work Among Seventh-day Adventists. So I'm just going to call it the 43 committee. And the LLC, or the Layman's Leadership Conference. So I'm going to be comparing those two grassroots movements in Adventist history. And then afterwards, we will have an esteemed panel, two of the daughters of the members of LLC, if you can imagine that. So we have church history here with us. So go with me on this journey. I want to give you a little bit of context on the 1943 committee. It is September of 1943. This is Lucy Byard's family. In the middle here, I hope you can see my cursor, is Lucy Byard. And to the right is her husband, James Byard. Now, Lucy Byard had the carcinoma of the liver. She had liver cancer. She was residing in New York City. And as the woman in the Bible, she did all she could. She went to all of the physicians, and the cancer was too advanced. And so, sort of as a last resort, she said, I want to try an Adventist hospital. I want to be among my people. She may have had it in mind that she was going to die soon. But she said, I want to be among my people. I want to be treated according to our health principles and be among fellow Adventists. And so one of the previous colored department directors, Jeter Cox, who was pastoring in New York City, arranged with the Washington, then it was Sanitarium, now it's Washington Adventist Hospital. He arranged for the hospital to admit her. But at the time, during the negotiations, the hospital did not know that she was Black. Right? So she, just to give a little more context, the hospital back then, it was a sanitarium, and it had more of a lifestyle element than perhaps it does now. And the simple thought, I would guess back then, they were sort of closer to the eight natural laws, or what we call creation today, the eight natural laws. And the entire Adventist health message one could undergo at the sanitarium. And a big part of that was the social aspect. As you can see here in the picture, what is that called? The name escapes me. The game with the balls. For some reason, I can't remember that name. It's been a long time since I've seen somebody play that game. Okay, so there was a whole fraternity element, a koinonia element, a social element at the sanitarium. Croquet, thank you. Thank you, croquet. It's been forever since I've even thought about that sport. Okay, so there was a whole social element at the sanitarium. And this would really come into the fore. Here you can see them all eating together, and rightly so. They believe that this social element could do much to bring health to someone. Anyhow, Lucy and James Byard traveled from New York City to Washington, D.C. on, they arrived September 22, 1943. And they arrived at the sanitarium. And of course, then the sanitarium personnel realized that Lucy Byard was indeed Black. The story has sort of been mistold, as many stories go. The mythology kind of grows up with it. You may recall playing that game when you were young, if you say one thing into someone's ear, and then by the time it gets to the, you know, sixth, seventh, eighth person, it's something totally different. So the story has since morphed. Some say that she was so light-skinned that they admitted her initially because they thought she was white, and then they looked at the form and they realized that she was Black. That wasn't the case. They thought that she was white initially, but then once they saw her, of course, they knew that she was Black. And essentially, James Byard says in a letter that he wrote later to the Negro Department Secretary, George E. Peters, that they told her that they indicated to the Byards that they were not welcome there and that they did not treat Negroes at the Washington Adventist Sanitarium. And instead, she should go across town. Remember that the sanitarium was on the Maryland DC line. And instead she should go across town to the Freedmen's Hospital, which is the Howard University Hospital. I won't tell you an irony now, or maybe I will. Now the Howard University Hospital is owned by the Adventist Health System. So that's one irony. I think, what, 3 or 4 years ago, the Adventist Health System took over the Howard University Hospital. But back then, it wasn't affiliated with the Adventists. They said, go over there to where the Negroes are. You are not welcomed here. So this is a picture of the Howard University Hospital around that time. Lucy Byard was admitted there. And in fact, there was a young Adventist intern named J. Mark Cox, who would later go on to be the director of the Riverside Sanitarium in Nashville, Tennessee. And Lucy Byard was treated there. Now, it's important to point out that Lucy Byard had not died yet when the 1943 committee was formed. Okay, that's an important point, that the outrage from the Lucy Byard incident came about because an Adventist woman who was a pioneer, by the way, in the building up of the Black work, of the Adventist work in New York City, that an Adventist woman was refused entry, a dying woman was refused entry in an Adventist hospital. And this was the same hospital that was supported by the tithe, by her very tithes and offerings, but she could not be seen there because of her race, And there was a lot of dissembling. And if you really want to get the real story on this, watch the YouTube video called The Real Lucy Byard Story. And that's on the Black SDA History YouTube site. It's called The Real Lucy Byard Story. And that shows some of the correspondence of the leaders of that time. And it shows that it was indeed rank racism. In fact, one of the leaders, the GC treasurer, said that the Sligo River separating the hospital and CUC, now Washington Adventist University, from the Black population in the area was not wide enough. So it was blatant racism why she was denied entrance into the hospital, lest that point be misunderstood. Here you see James Byard writes to G.E. Peters. And once again, this is available to you if you watch the video on the site. Lucy Byard ended up dying October 22. So she died about, I believe that's the date. Someone can double check me. But she died about a month later after she was not admitted to the Washington Sanitarium. So she did not die because she was rejected. Although someone may extrapolate that. Someone could say that the heartache and the rejection did not help at all. But she ultimately died, once again, I think, ironically, of cachexia, which means to waste away. And it almost denotes a neglect. But it was cachexia from carcinoma of the liver. The 1943 committee was actually formed a couple of weeks after Lucy Byard's rejection at the hospital, at the Washington Sanitarium, when she was still alive at the Freedmen's Hospital. And it really came about after a message from a white General Conference president at the Black church, Ephesus Church, in Washington, D.C., in which the Lucy Byard story was percolating, and it was, you know, black Adventists were in an uproar, and they were apoplectic over what had happened. And a white General Conference vice president by the name of Turner preached a sermon that said, "Think it not strange that these fiery trials have come upon you." And so he was essentially saying to Blacks in the audience that this is all just a part of being like Christ, and you're going to get over this trial. And here you see some of the lay people that heard the sermon that morning from one of the GC vice presidents, and that night in Dodson's bookstore. Now this was Willie Anna Dodson. You can see her there. You can see her there, second from the left on the second row, and her husband Joseph. Their bookstore right near Howard University. A group of lay people, all of those you can see there, they got together and formed what's called the Committee for the Advancement of the Worldwide Work Among Colored Seventh-day Adventists. And this is what Doug Morgan's book is about that I mentioned earlier, Change Agents. And you may recognize a lot of these people. Although these were lay people, this was a high-powered group. You see Valerie Justice, later Vance. She was an early Adventist PhD. Eva B. Dykes was the first Black woman to complete the requirements for a PhD, which she did in 1921. You see James R. Montgomery. You see Willa Anna Dodson, J. Estelle Barnett. In Zanesville, Ohio, there is a Black cultural center named after her because of the civil rights, because of her civil rights efforts. You see Addison Pinckney. Later, he was a president of Oakwood College. Of course, Grace Kimbrough, one of the most legendary Adventist physicians, and J. Mark Cox, who I mentioned earlier. So they all got together and said, instead of putting the onus of eradicating racism in the church on a leader, or letting some ministry handle it, or letting the pastoral staff handle it, we're going to take this up ourselves. They said, we must get rid of the injustice in the Adventist church. And they immediately began to talk to fellow lay people. They prayed to God, and they appealed to Adventist leadership, both Black and white. Their simple message was, something has to be done so that an atrocity like the Byard incident will not occur again. Now, they are most well known for a pamphlet that they put together called "Shall the Four Freedoms Function Among Seventh-day Adventists?" And of course, this is a play on President Franklin Roosevelt's Four Freedoms talk during the Great Depression, years before. And in this pamphlet, they systematically outlined the racism that was occurring in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And please just Google this pamphlet. You can find a PDF of it. And if not, I will send it. I will make it available to you. I will be sure to put it on the website if it is not on there already. But they systematically outline the racism that occurred in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and from the Bible and Spirit of Prophecy showed why exactly it was unbiblical. And this is one theme that you will see in these protest movements. They come from the Bible. They come from the Spirit of Prophecy, particularly the Southern work. They come from the natural rights of humans, and they come from the U.S. Constitution. So this is deeply grounded in all sorts of founding documents, if you will. But they systematically detail the racial practices in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. They say on every level, in leadership, Blacks are not represented. They said that the Black leaders are only over the Black work, and that is only recently where could Blacks even lead other Blacks. When Blacks are in leadership, they're not involved in any of the major committees. In fact, at the time, Blacks could not even eat in the General Conference cafeteria. G.E. Peters constantly experienced this. There actually was a push to desegregate the General Conference cafeteria itself. They said on every academic level of the church, from college to elementary school to kindergartens, the church is segregated. Some Adventist schools admit Black people, others do not, and most of them have a quota. And that quota was a very small quota that said only this amount of Blacks can be admitted. So they outline how Black Adventists were paying tithe, and they were giving a disproportionate amount of tithe, and very little of that tithe was coming back to the Black ministry. The Black ministry was neglected. They did not have opportunities for evangelistic work. They had no institutions. They had Oakwood College, but they didn't have anything in the North. They had very few primary and secondary schools. So this was just a complete racial and racist system that they outlined. And they set forth what they were demanding very clearly: more representation in leadership, parity in monetary allotment, the desegregation of Adventist schools, more institutions for Black Adventists, since obviously they weren't being admitted into white Adventist institutions. And they even specified, we want a Black editor of Message magazine. Up to that point, there had only been white editors of Message magazine. Now, of course, the committee ultimately was able to speak directly to General Conference leaders, Black and white, and ultimately their efforts, they were constantly appealing to leadership. They were dogged in their determination to change the racist mores and policies of the Adventist Church. And ultimately, their efforts, I think, more than anything else, led to the creation of regional conferences. Watch this. When the white leadership was presented with integration, or let's not even say integration, let's say desegregation of their institutions, of their leadership, or separate conferences, they opted for separate conferences. Separate conferences were not the idea of Black Adventists. Black Adventists wanted integration, if only because, you know, whites had better facilities. You know, the opportunities were better with whites. I mean, you know, and so white Adventists said, no, we don't want to go that route. We don't want desegregation. We don't want integration. We will go for separate conferences. And this is really the history of separate conferences. Blacks were not pushing for that. Blacks wanted integration, but whites said, no, we can't do that. So let's have separate conferences. And of course, other other measures were taken. Pine Forge was established shortly after. Of course, Lewis B. Reynolds became the first Black editor of Message magazine. But ultimately, from this movement came Black administered conferences or regional conferences. Okay, moving along very quickly. These are some of the, and now we're moving to the 1960s. I know that this is a very, very fast moving talk, but now we're moving to the 1960s. And this movement is what I consider to be the second efficacious grassroots movement in our Seventh-day Adventist past. And this is the Laymen's Leadership Committee, or the LLC. Here you can see some of the major leaders of the movement. Once again, we have two of the daughters of these illustrious individuals, Frank W. Hale Jr., who was the leader, Miles Martin, who was a journalist and agitator par excellence, J. Estelle Barnett, who was a civil rights worker educator in Ohio, and Bonnie and Burrell Scott, who were also leaders in the LLC. Okay, I'm running out of time, but I will try to move as fast as possible. Okay, the LLC really came about in the mind of Frank Hale when he personally experienced rank discrimination at Adventist schools when he tried to enroll his daughter, who is here with us today, into Mount Vernon Academy, and they essentially denied her application and said that she should go to Pine Forge instead. And really, this is an analog of the Lucy Byard experience, and it happened over and over again. These institutions that Black Adventists were paying tithe to and for and supporting, they're saying, you can't come here, go to the black school. That's for you. And Hale had visited a number of Adventist academies, and he had discovered that they had quotas. And because he was asking, you know, what if my daughter wanted to come here? Well, sir, we have a quota of 3 and it's already filled. So that's what Hale was told. And this is sort of the activism that we want to see come back to the church. It's not you go and complain on social media when you encounter this racism. It's not you go and talk to a leader. You do something yourself. Hale knew that the onus was on him. And sometime you have to become the leader and do something about it. So Hale was a very empowered individual. He was, I would say he was definitely a part of, you know, if you've read Angels Watching Over Me, you know his background. He was a devotee of Black empowerment. Okay, I would say that he was something like, if you all get this reference, he was an Adam Clayton Powell of Adventism, if I can say that. But Dr. Hale was very empowered. Of course, I had the pleasure of knowing him. And so he said, something needs to be done. And so he was speaking at the Oakwood Alumni Association of Chicago. And there he recommended an organization to combat the racial injustice that was going on in the Adventist Church and to reconcile Blacks and whites. A long story short, the Laymen's Leadership Conference, and for some reason I have committee on one and conference on another, but the LLC, we will call it, was formed in Columbus, Ohio. And as I said, it was formed by lay people. So this is another grassroots movement of very empowered Ohioan Adventists. If you go to a certain time in Black history, it seemed like everything was happening in Ohio. So this was where the LLC was formed, and essentially their raison d'etre was ironically similar to the 1943 committee. And that was to desegregate Adventism, to get more representation in leadership, to end the quota system, equal distribution of monies. It was essentially the same raison d'etre. Okay. But this time I think that the efforts and the modus operandi of the LLC was perhaps a little more militant. And this would really come about with Miles Martin, who was a media wunderkind. And believe it or not, he was kind of the radical voice, while Dr. Hale was the moderate voice. So Miles Martin was like, let's take all this to the secular media and tell them exactly what's going on in our church. Dr. Hale was like, Miles, you know, hold on. I encourage you to read Out of the Trash Came Truth, because Dr. Hale was like, Miles was a genius, but he was very rash. And it was like the nuclear option. And so the group would meet together. And one thing that I like about the 43 committee and the 60, 61, 62 LLC is that women had a prominent role in each of these movements. And this didn't necessarily reflect the larger civil rights movement, which was largely male chauvinist. I mean, of course, obviously, we have important women in those movements, but they were largely suppressed, really, if you study it. Whereas in the 43 committee and the LLC, women played an extremely prominent role, which makes sense, because it wasn't one minority suppression for another. There was sort of an equality in these movements. Okay, so I'm wrapping up. The LLC had these kind of Adam Clayton Powell-ish, let's say SCLC type drives. The parent drive was one in which the LLC encouraged Black Adventist parents to purposely enroll their kids in segregated Adventist schools. And so you can definitely see some parallels to this, to what was going on in the larger civil rights movement. They hold a historic meeting in Springfield, Ohio. And here they devise their strategy for the upcoming San Francisco General Conference session, which would happen in about a month. And that's when they decided, okay, we will have an office headquarters, the Jack Tar Hotel. We will distribute flyers. We will sell the Southern work. And that was one of the frontispieces of the movement, Ellen White's statements in the Southern work. That's why I do kind of find it ironic where there tends to be throughout our history the opposite, that Ellen White was in fact racist. So many of these groups took her as their inspiration. Anyhow, they were going to hold meetings concurrently with the General Conference session. They were going to circulate petitions around race, recruit new members, and they were going to hold a rally. So before the General Conference session, Hale and the leaders of the LLC reached out to the General Conference. They had already met with the General Conference leaders once, but they reached out again and said, we want to meet with you, because we need to get some things straight for this session. We need some things done at this session. The General Conference leaders refused to meet with Hale and the LLC. And Frank Hale writes, the die was cast. I knew now that it would be necessary to go directly to the press. So he's been listening to Martin. And thus far, he's kind of held off Miles Martin's nuclear approach. Because, you know, Adventists are all about publish it, not in Ascalon. You know, don't tell worldly people our dirt, what's going on in here. But here Hale says the die was cast. I knew now that it would be necessary to go directly to the press in order for any meaningful dialogue to occur between LLC officers and the president of the General Conference, Elder R.R. Figueroa. His final slap in the face was glaringly unacceptable. So the LLC holds a rally in the Jack Tar Hotel, and the rally is a dizzying success, about 1,000 attend, standing room only, And that's when J. Estelle Barnett and Frank Hale speak, and their talks are so rousing that it just set the tone for their activities of the entire General Conference session. So the General Conference session commences on July 26th. Here you can see I made a meme of J. Estelle Barnett's speech. She said, "The racists in our midst have been convinced of the truth, but haven't gotten within a breath of being converted." And so here we have Black Adventists, like Blacks in America, as Blacks held America up to its democratic standards and said, "You are not truly a democracy. There's no liberty here because of how you treat us." Adventists do the same and say, "You claim to be converted, but you're not converted while you are treating us in this racist manner." And so Blacks are always, I think Blacks have always been the true Americans, because we truly believed in liberty. We truly believed in democracy. I've also believed that Adventists have always been, Black Adventists have always been the true Adventists, because we are the true Protestants. We are truly those who hold Adventists, white Adventists and other Adventists, up to that Christ-like standard and say, "You have to do this to be an Adventist. You cannot be a true Adventist while you're treating others like this. This is not what we're about." So this is J. Estelle Barnett. Here is a scene from the, you know, these GC photos. This is a wide shot of the General Conference session. Here are people coming into the hall. And here's the Jack Tar Hotel in 1962. So this is where it all went down, in the Jack Tar Hotel. This is where the LLC headquarters was. Okay, so they decided to take the nuclear option, as Miles Martin had suggested, and they were talking to the secular media. And I'm telling you, read the newspaper reports of the day. I will cut them all out. I'll get on newspaper.com, cut them all out, put them on blacksdahistory.org. They are sensational, as was the style back in the day. It's like, "Adventist racist, Adventists are Jim Crow, Adventists were failed to listen to Blacks, Adventists treat Blacks like second-class citizens," and the very photogenic Burrell and Bonnie Scott are in many of the headlines, because, you know, they were a beautiful couple. So they're like, you know, what newspapers would do back in the day oftentimes was take representative Black people, beautiful Black people, and put them up when they wanted to make a point. So that's what they did with Burrell and Bonnie Scott. And of course, they were leaders of the LLC. So the news of what LLC was doing at the session appeared in the New York Times, San Francisco Chronicle, Newsweek, Time, Jet, all of these publications. As a result, it was sort of a small victory, because Frank Hale was very dissonant about F.L. Peterson in Out of the Trash Came Truth. Because if you know anything about Hale, Peterson was his mentor, and he had tremendous respect for Peterson. In fact, if I recall, he started the Frank Loris Peterson Society for Columbus Adventists at Ephesus, if I recall. I think I went to one of their retreats. So he had tremendous respect for F.L. Peterson. But I'll just say this. As a result of the LLC and their agitation at the General Conference session, they elected the first Black president of the GC, F.L. Peterson. But with all respect, he seemed to be the safest Negro they could hire. Okay? I'm just saying that. Okay? He was safe. He was an organizational man. He was a company man. Dr. Hale calls him an organization man. And he tried to sort of bring the two together. In fact, he told the newspapers that there wasn't a segregation problem in Adventism. So he sort of sold the LLC out because he was towing the line. So they said, "This is a safe Negro, but he's Negro nonetheless." So they hired F.L. Peterson as the first Black General Conference vice president. And the LLC really won the minds of the people at that GC session. One of the big steps was when more than 100 Black Adventist pastors and leaders expressed their support for the LLC, and that was including C.E. Bradford and others. So they really won the general public support and many within Adventism, their support. Okay, my last slide, comparing the 1943 committee and the LLC, both were grassroots. They were comprised of lay people, and they actually, both of them said that they avoided church workers joining their movements because the church members were like on strings. They were controlled by the denomination, who ultimately had their paychecks and who had their sympathies. So they said, we're only going for lay people who are free from that burden. Very, very shrewd. They heavily featured women leadership, which I think was a key. They advocated for racial equality. Like I said, they drew from these foundational documents, the Bible in Adventism's case, the foundational documents are the Spirit of Prophecy and the U.S. Constitution. They pushed for Black representation and equity. Both utilized the secular media to push and goad the church to reform. And they had a good deal of success. And finally, they took the onus on themselves to change the church and didn't leave it up to ministers, pastors, or the church leadership. Thank you very much.
Dr. Baker, thank you so much for that riveting, inspirational presentation. It was just wonderful. And I just thank God for you. Appreciate what you have shared. And we have a great panel discussion. And it's my distinct privilege and honor to recognize a who's who amongst moderators, amongst communication professionals in the Adventist Church. I had the privilege of meeting her while she was still young, because she's still young now, when she was at WSJM in Benton Harbor. And I was always fascinated by her professionalism, her swag, her expertise, and her knowing how to get to the grit of the story. She later worked for a U.S. congressperson and has had a stellar career in voiceovers, being a communications director, and now serves as assistant to the president and director of communications for the Potomac Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. If you don't know her, it's your loss. But welcome the prime, the pristine, the elegant, the witty, the intelligent, and insightful, still looking for herself, Deborah Anderson. Deborah, welcome to the broadcast, and we'll take it over from there.
Thank you so much, Ed. Ben, I concur. When he introduces you, you have to turn around and look and see to whom is he speaking? What? But thank you so much. It is a pleasure to be with you. Ben, I have to tell you that I was sitting here saying more and more. I want more. I want to drink from this fountain of knowledge that you are giving us tonight. Many of us have read some of these stories and know some of this history. But when you can put it together and put the faces with the names, it just brings the story to life. And tonight we're going to be talking with our panelists about what an LLC would look like in 2021. Is it needed? Who would be on it? Who are the Frank Hales? Who are the Milas Martins of 2021? And what issues would we be addressing? So let me introduce to you now our panelists for the evening. This woman, this doctor, this force in her own right really doesn't need much of an introduction. If I simply say her name, everybody knows who I'm talking about, and everybody knows her heritage. Dr. Ifeoma Kwesi is an associate professor at the School of Religion at Oakwood University. Her father, Dr. Frank Hale. Dr. Kwesi is a former pastor and a hospital chaplain. She, again, is the daughter of Dr. Frank Hale, who was a founding member and co-chair of the LLC. You're going to be riveted by her stories tonight as well. And her friend, Erica Scott Wright, she was born and raised in Oberlin, Ohio. A lifelong learner, she continues to defy the odds and triumphs through life's trials and tribulations. These ladies were best friends back in the day and still good friends, I can tell you, just from the way I have seen them interact this evening. But it was them. LLC was actually born in your living room, Dr. Kwesi, in Columbus, Ohio, if I'm not mistaken. So we're going to get to that in a moment. And Nicole Phillips joins us. Nicole is a lawyer. She serves as the communications director and policy advisor for a member of the U.S. House of Representatives. And everybody's first question is going to be, where were you on January 6th? She'll fill you in on that part as well. She's a graduate of Pine Forge Academy and Oakwood University. Nicole continues to hone her voice as an advocate on the front lines of social justice. And Ben Baker cannot leave this conversation now, not when he's gotten us oh so all riled up. So thank you all for joining us. We appreciate you being here and the knowledge and history that you're going to provide us tonight. Dr. Kwesi, if you could tell us again, LLC was born literally, your father gave birth to it in your living room.
Dad was chair of the English department at Central State University at that time. We were in Wilberforce, Ohio. And Erica and her family were in Oberlin. And as was mentioned, we had planned to be roommates at Mount Vernon Academy and had been denied admission to the academy, given direction to Pine Forge, had applied then to all of the academies in the surrounding states and had also been denied. And that became the catalyst for Burl Scott, Miles Martin, Frank Hale, as well as Mrs. Bonnie Scott and Estelle Barnett. I remember her so fondly saying, we just can't let this ride. We've got to address this. So, yeah.
And what were some of the excuses, the reasons that you were denied entrance, Erica?
Well, one of the reasons was that just my color, mainly.
Were they that blatant with it?
Oh, yes. Very much so. Very much so. They knew I had come from a church school out in the country that was connected to Mount Vernon. So, you know, what is it, Academy Days that you go to?
Right.
Yeah, so that was my first chance, you know, to see Mount Vernon. Beautiful campus. Beautiful. Look forward to it. You know, as Ifeoma says, you know, we're going to be roommates here. But they had no other reason than, as the letter said to my mother, would be more comfortable at a school for my people. And we all know what that means when they bring that out, my people. Hang on, there we go.
Right.
So you're but that was it.
You're in eighth grade, ninth grade?
Mm-hmm. Eighth grade.
You're innocent. And by that I mean that you've not experienced a lot of racism. And so how did that kind of blatant feeling of how did that make you feel? How were you left feeling? And this is for both of you.
Yeah. Shock number one for me anyway. Coming from Oberlin, which was a college town, and very proud of Oberlin because they were the first to have women, and the first woman was a Black woman. So I grew up in this very liberal atmosphere. And to have my people, and I'm thinking Adventists, okay, not color, Adventists, but they were thinking color, not Adventist. And it hurt. It really did. It hurt quite a bit.
Did it leave you bitter?
Oh, Lord, yes. Yes.
Angry?
very angry, very angry.
My experience was somewhat different in that I had encountered racism earlier in Springfield, Ohio, where my grandparents lived and where we had our church membership. We would exchange what was then called MV programs, now AY. And we did that across the conference, but we tried to do it with the white church. And we always referred to them as our sister church. They always referred to us as the colored church. Yeah. So, and because I grew up in the South, see, Dad taught at Oakwood when I was a kid before he got his doctorate and then went back and taught some more before he went to Central State. So I had already encountered racism, but it wasn't until we were in attempting to make this outreach to the white church to exchange an MV program that I saw it in the church. That was my first time seeing it in the church.
That is, you know, church is where we go to find a place of refuge. It's where we go to find peace. It's where we go to find love. And so when we see and experience anything different than that, it usually knocks us off of our equilibrium. Let me bring Nicole in here for just a moment, and then I want to get back to your story. Nicole, what you're hearing, you grew up, you graduated from Oakwood in 2007. So much of what you have heard this evening already is not your experience. Would that be right?
Absolutely. That's correct. Absolutely.
And so the America that you live in now, the world of Adventism that you live in now, looks a little bit differently than that of these ladies. You went to Pine Forge, you went to Oakwood, and so you were surrounded by like-minded people. But with that said, do you see in your experience now, you went to law school in the Midwest, and we know that in different parts of the country, the different cultures react differently and are treated differently. So your experience of late in your grad school years, does it any of that resonate with what you're hearing?
So like many things as it relates to the complicated story of America, there are some changes, there is progress, but a lot of things don't really change. They just kind of shift the way it's presented. For example, I went to law school in the city of Chicago. In Chicago in particular, you know, they sometimes call New York the great melting pot. And I like to think of Chicago, if I compare that, is a very well-organized freezer. And when you consider the way strategically communities have been separated and the role of politics, laws, and rules that help to keep that in space. Yeah. So while I am in a law school that's downtown Chicago, and I see the great buildings, the great museums, I also went into communities as a student, talking to students in those, you know, in the South and in the West about your rights. And I hear the stories they tell about the brutality, the young men and the young women that they experience regularly. I see the deplorable conditions, some of our communities that are majority Black. It's a city that's rich of African-American, but the opportunities and the conditions that have been intentionally created in many ways was disturbing to see. Especially when you feel like you have moved to a place of progress in our nation and you see some of the continued disparities. Coming to DC and Capitol Hill has been a different level of eye-opening to see just some of the disappointments, honestly, of public service and the way folks are motivated and the way that manifests in our laws and the disenfranchisement that we see constantly. So that has been more so my experience of seeing, you know, Jim Crow laws not on the books blatantly, but the spirit of it is still alive and well.
And is that same spirit, Ben, do we see that same spirit manifest in the church today? Because in the 40s and the 60s, I mean, it was just everywhere. Do we see those same kinds of racial challenges, or are they more microaggressions that we're seeing?
Believe it or not.
Go ahead.
Sorry, Nicole, please take it.
So just very briefly from my experience, I would say more microaggressions. The content is different now. There's once a forced segregation, and then more so a de facto segregation for other various reasons. But I think it comes a lot with leadership and decision making and who's in the room and who's at the table when that happens. So I see more issues in that space. And honestly, I remember being a student at Oakwood, and we would work with Southern universities and the leaders, student leaders at that time, to come together and kind of have those conversations. Infrequently, we'll get deep into the issues of race or racism and how that might play a role. It's avoided almost, trying to get into those deeper conversations or touchy conversations. I think one of the main issues has been the cultural conflict or cultural discomforts that are really hindering our Christian principles. And when we need to really recognize how to put aside areas of discomfort, and understanding that this is not a Christianity is not a place to compromise. Politics is about compromise, but we need to be a little more firm, clear, and transparent when it comes to spaces of our Christian principles and how we relate to each other.
Ben, can we let Dr. Kwesi make her comment, and then I come back to you, please.
I believe that it is as embedded now as it ever was. I think white supremacy has been a part of the fabric and grounding of Adventism from day one. And I know that when high-ranking African-Americans within the Adventist administration have attempted to put racism on the agenda for the next general conference, it has been categorically shot down. It will not be addressed, period. Sure. It's not going anywhere. It's not going anywhere.
Ben, you're nodding your head in agreement.
Yeah, I think both Dr. Kwesi and Nicole touched on it, especially when Nicole said culture. I think that that's one of the hidden elements of racism in the church, and that is the white culture is still the norm, or someone may call it invisible. And that means that it is the standard, it is the culture, so everything else is looked at as culture, because the white Adventist culture is the culture. So I still see a lot of maybe inadvertent cultural imperialism, if you will, especially around worship, around expression, around ways of engagement with the community, around principles and policies, you name it. I would also say that in Adventism, you have a unique dynamic. And this is very subtle. This is very subtle. When you start having more representation, and I'm speaking of Black leadership, you immediately take that Black figurehead and you say everything's okay because we now have a Black leader. In fact, some studies show that normal Blacks, regular Blacks, do worse under Black leaders. I'm talking about political leaders, because they say everything's all right because we have a Negro in office. And so we don't need to push for equality anymore. Everything's okay. And that's a very, very subtle point, but it's there. I would also say that in Adventism, there's another dynamic, and that is with regional conferences, really what that did was it cemented separation. Okay, it cemented segregation in the church in many respects. And so at that time, what I'm saying is that it cemented a reality that was already there, but it then became systematic. Mm-hmm. So systematically, we were separated into different conferences. And when that occurs, there's not as much racial mixing that happens. So you really don't see the racism. You really don't know how other people feel about you. Yeah. Like the call to desegregate conferences and combine the conferences that really started, I don't know, about 15 or so years ago. People are saying, well, you can segregate, you can combine the conferences again, but the local churches outside of large metropolitan areas will still largely be Black, white, Hispanic, and Asian, separate. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so you can now desegregate it institutionally, but what will happen on the ground level? So I think that the rubber would really meet the road if we were always around each other, mm-hmm, in very close and intimate spaces. Then you would really see it, like, you know, when the Black man brings the white girl home to his parents and vice versa. You know, when things really get close, then the racial attitudes really come to the fore.
And I think that if you,
Baker, you made a point earlier about the issue that when Lucy Byards was denied access at the Washington Sand, that her tithe dollars that had been supporting that institution now did not benefit her. And Isaac Palmer has done some real in-depth research on the degree to which there is a serious disparity in terms of financial and economic issues with regard to how our tithe dollars are used differently, such that we don't have as many church schools and any number of other issues that he has raised. And so I think that the inherent caste system that Isabel Wilkerson talks about in her book is very, very evident here in the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
I'm sure it is. And I think also that if you talk to people who work in the Adventist Church with different cultures, you are going to find that most of them will say, I have to leave, or let me rephrase. Some of them have said, I have to leave this area of employment where I am if I am going to remain a Christian and a Seventh-day Adventist, because those microaggressions come out. I can recount a story to you recently that I heard of a young woman who was working at a local Adventist institution and as a floater, and they needed a machine fixed. Nobody knew how to fix this machine. And so she came around and she said, well, has anyone read the manual? No one had read the manual. So she read the manual and fixed the machine. One of the people that was there said to her, oh, you're so smart. Have you ever thought about going to college? She said, as a matter of fact, I have two college degrees. Why would she say that? And so those kinds of things still happen within our church. And if we don't admit that and face that head on, these things are going to continue to happen. And I think it's incumbent upon each of us to call it out when we see it as best as we can. So let me ask you this question, and I'm going to throw this out to anyone who wants to answer it. Is there a need for an LLC 2021? This is the 60th anniversary. Given what is happening in the country, and the church is a microcosm of the country, yes. Do we need an LLC 2021? And if we do, what would we be addressing specifically?
Well, I think we do need an organization like the LLC today, because racism has not gone away in the church. And I don't know, it's just today, the times we're living in. We used to be more civil, you know, to each other. People hid their, you know, their racism, things like this, you know. But now it's all out there. Nobody cares. you know, being a Christian is okay to hate my neighbor because they're Black. You follow what I'm saying here?
Mm-hmm.
Just trying to find the right words. The openness of people, you know, showing this dark side mm-hmm. of themselves.
Has it become more prevalent in the last few years, do you think?
Oh, yeah. I do.
Like in America, in the church?
Mm-hmm. I do. Yes. Which is still there. And I think it's going to get worse. I honestly think the time will come, you know, where maybe even in a church pulpit, you know, I believe it's just going to get worse for us as Black people, people of color.
Dr. Baker, would you agree?
I was listening to Dr. Calvin Rock, and I say this with a big smile on my face. It was a program called Advent Next. And he was being interviewed about his new book by Kendra Arsenault. And he made some comments that essentially inferred that we should kind of let white people have some room from us if they want. He was talking about white flight. And so it was such an interesting comment. So the church is white, and then a lot of Black people come and they flee to another church.
Yeah.
And this happens with schools and other institutions.
Right.
And Dr. Rock, let them go if they want.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We should not force, now that everything is desegregated, we should not push for forced integration, which is different. Desegregation, you can come in. Mm-hmm. Anyone can come in. But integration kind of means, well, perhaps it has an implication of force,
mm-hmm.
but it may be voluntary as well. Okay. So my answer to your very, very interesting question, Sister Anderson, very, very thought-provoking question, I think I've never been asked that before, is it depends on how close we want to get to people. I've done something like the LLC. The LLC solicited letters of racial experiences, of racist experiences from Black Adventists.
Mm-hmm.
And they got letters from all over of racial incidents. I've done similar things and heard of those instances, but they are very interpersonal because now it's against the law to have segregation. In fact, Dr. Samuel London writes in his book, Seventh-day Adventists and the Civil Rights Movements, that Nicole can help me with the name here. The Education Secretary of the United States, I think Katzenberger, called the Southern Union president in like 1961 and said, Adventists are the last to desegregate their schools, their primary schools. You have to do it now. Nowadays, that's against the law.
Right.
The church wouldn't be funded. They would lose subsidies. They would, all sorts of things would happen if they did that. So it's against the law to have blatant segregation. So it goes underground. It manifests itself in other ways interpersonally. And so I think now what we need, because we know that racism manifests itself in all, it's very malleable and mutative. Okay. So I think that now what we need more is something on an interpersonal and very personal level, as opposed to something systematic, because now that is against the law. And so it's mutated into other forms. That's a subtle point, but I could speak more about that.
Dr. Kwesi, I see your face. You look like you want to say something. I see it all over you.
You have to understand that I struggle with being Adventist. It is an embarrassment.
Mm-hmm.
I have critical thinking friends outside of the Adventist church who cannot understand how in the world I can be a part of an organization that unapologetically practices racism and sexism. They say, girlfriend, they won't even ordain you. What the heck are you doing up in there?
Yeah.
And that's a whole different topic. That's a whole different topic. Mm-hmm. But my point is, we're looking to evangelize people who no longer swallow hook, line, and sinker anything that comes from a pulpit. They think it through. They watch to see if there is any correlation between your profession and your practice. And they say, I don't need all that to get to heaven. And so I just, like I said, I struggle. I tell people I'm a recovering Adventist, you know, because because quite frankly, I have left and come back more than once. Okay. Only through the conviction of the Holy Spirit. I'm a Pan-Africanist at heart, you know? And so I just, you know, struggle to make sure that I'm not guilty of the same thing that I accused white Christians who can vote for a Donald Trump and allow my culture to transcend Christ. At the end of the day, I'm not going to catch hell here and then go to hell, but if I have anything to do with it, I need to stay as close to Christ as possible. And it is very difficult in an atmosphere that has been stoked by the last person who occupied the Oval Office. As was said, as Erica said, it's all out front now. Okay, January 6th was a clear and convincing, you know, expedition of where we are. And so whether it's, you know, a George Floyd or a Breonna Taylor or an Ahmaud Arbery, I mean, the list just goes on and on in terms of what I have to pray about. You know, Lord, you want me to love my enemies. Lord, help me, first of all, to remember to pray for them. OK, yeah. maybe that'll be a step in learning to love them. And so I'm my father's child for real, for real. And I am militant to the bone. My name was Ifeoma Kwesi is not on my birth certificate. OK, I changed my name on purpose to identify with my African ancestry and to make a statement about what I believe to be a very important part of my identity. I was always Black first and Adventist second. I had to learn to be Christian first and African American second. So, and to me, that's a very important distinction. Okay. Yeah. I'm not as invested in my Adventism as I am in my Christianity. And I know as a professor in the School of Theology at Oakwood University, I could very well lose my job behind that, but they already know that. They already know who I am. And, you know, in the classroom, I am always promoting transformation through a relationship with Jesus Christ.
Right. And that's what it's all about. And
absolutely.
That's what you are saying resonates with the young people of today. And Nicole, if you would speak to this, and not that you're speaking for all young people, but I have found that the younger people could care less about Adventism, more about Christianity, and have a low tolerance and little patience for this thing about women and ordination. And they're not going to do the same thing that my age group did, or that my parents' age group did, who didn't happen to sit at the feet of Dr. Hale or the Scotts. You know, they're not going to quietly sit by and just let it happen. They're not. And so, Nicole, speak to that if you would.
Our realities are different. There are different cultural contexts when it comes to the different generations. So what our expectations are, what is acceptable, what we are expected to deal with, totally different in many regards. So we are looking at a White House with the first woman vice president. So the conversation about women not being able to ordain, and, you know, there's so many men out here quoting Ellen G. White at the same time. It's just very confusing and not really acceptable. So Also, the manner in which some of the principles, Adventist principles, have been presented to some young folk have been more coercive, less about the love and the freedom of the gospel. And that just presentation has, it shifts more towards rebellion than understanding acceptance and wanting to feel a part of something like that. So Christianity, that's the conflict, that's the issue. We're seeing a contradiction sometimes with Adventism and Christianity, or the spirit of Christianity, what it should be. So like Dr. Kwesi said, Christian first, Adventist second perhaps. But I think it is also still important for the younger generations as well to understand that we are not following people, we are following God, the principles that we are understanding from that. So while people may fail us, we have to disassociate the failures of people and the counsel that we're getting from the Word. So while it's important to call it wrong when we see it, and continue to call out sexism, racism, injustice, and acknowledge the injustice or the inhumanity of inaction, which is another issue that we see sometimes when it comes to being more or organized and politically involved, organized activism. So that inaction as well, and not hearing the voice from some of our leaders, is a powerful point that needs to be recognized. One of the differences, the main differences, I think, with what's going on right now, the today's church, LLC, and what happened in 43, is that their asks seem to be very clear. So the organization around what they were asking was more concentrated and clear. So with the current state of the Adventist Church, what integration, like Dr. Baker was mentioning, what would that even look like actually? What could it look like? I don't think if our asks are not clear, what our expectations are not clear, it's hard to organize around that. But if we do want change, we need greater understanding and transparency. And then that's something that I think is entirely appropriate to coordinate and organize on.
So with that, what is our ask? What do we want? I saw something that came up in the chat a few minutes ago that said, is it time for there to be an African-American Seventh-day Adventist denomination?
You know, what's funny about that, I chuckled when I saw that. I teach a class, a graduate class on worship, and I had my students watch Skip Gates' two-part documentary on PBS on the Black Church. And any number of my of the comments that I got from those that I work with were dismayed that Oakwood was never mentioned. I said, we're not a Black church. I'm like, well, yeah, no, we're not, okay? You know, and so... You know, helping them to recognize the difference between being an independent Black church like the AME or AME Zion or Kojic or what have you. You know, it is a very different reality. What I help them to recognize is that most Adventists don't even live in the United States. Most Adventists, okay, are people of color. Most Adventists are women, and yet never has there been a GC president that wasn't a white male. Okay, so you know, when you look at what the difference is in the framework and the structure and the purpose of an independent Black church versus a church that has a large number of Black members in their own conferences, in their own churches, there's very, very different, very different.
So do you think Seventh-day Adventist African-American denomination would flourish?
I would just say something very quickly, and I'm not taking a stand on that either way, but I do want to say this. One thing that Sister Erica and Dr. Kwesi's parents and their contemporaries and those before them were big on was loyalty to the Seventh-day Adventist organization. Mm-hmm. Now, their loyalty was first to the truth and to Jesus. Mm-hmm. Let's get that straight. But they also believed in the integrity of the organization. In fact, leaders like G.E. Peters, J.G. Dasent, F.L. Peterson, H.R. Murphy, J.H. Wagner, you name the leader. They would often suffer blatant racism at the general conference, in committees, couldn't eat at the cafeteria, slights here, couldn't go there. And they would not tell their members because their members would lose their faith and leave the church. That's how dedicated they were to the actual Seventh-day Adventist organization. They believed in it because they made it. Mm-hmm. This was not them believing in the white man's organization. They put their blood, sweat, and tears into that organization. Okay, here's my statement. My statement is, Nicole's generation, my generation, we're not sold on an organization like that. So if, for the people who are listening on the, you know, in the audience, if you believe that something is sacrosanct or holy about the church organization and about even paying tithes and offerings and, you know, quaint things like that, okay, the future is going to look pretty stark, because I don't think that there's a fealty, that there's a faithfulness to the organization in the upcoming generations. And so this question is going to have to be litigated, because I do not see any faithfulness to the organization itself. I'm saying the apparatus, the structure, the government structure of the church that the previous generation had. So there's going to be a crisis in the church.
And I think that COVID, the fact that we are not gathering like we used to, we will never, and you've heard this 100,000 times over and over again, and people are going to keep saying it, the church as we have known it is gone. It does not exist. And it is going to be the young people that are going to take us into this next era. Mm-hmm. And the rest of us have to be ready to accept that there are going to be more people in heaven than just Seventh-day Adventists.
Oh, for sure.
Okay. Yeah. We have to accept that. We have to move about it. And we have to embrace and support our children when they begin to question things. Just because you question does not mean that you disagree. It simply means that you want to know more and you want to have somebody look at it analytically.
I think also historically, if we look at Lewis Sheaf, if we look at Humphreys, we look at Mann, these are three gentlemen, preachers, who attempted to have an independent Seventh Day or a Sabbath Day Adventist denomination, and it didn't work. And that's not to forecast the future. I'm just saying it has been tried in the past, because people have been, you know, very discouraged by the racism that they encountered. I'm not advocating for a jumping of the ship. I don't think that my salvation depends upon my relationship to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I think my salvation depends on my relationship to Jesus Christ. And like Black folks who have built America, okay, we have also built this church, as was said. And so, you know, we have every right to stay and make it what it should be, as opposed to leaving it because it isn't at its ideal, in its operation or in its even in its ideology.
I want to give everyone an opportunity to, there was a question, and I can't see it now, it went away, but it had to do with January 6th, and, you know, racism did not just appear on January 6th. It's been there. It's been latent, and now it's all out in the forefront, has been coming out for the last 4 years or more, let's say. And so we're dealing with it, but we're also dealing with it. It has brought up, and I'm sure each of you could speak to this, conversations within people in the church that you have that might not look like us with our Caucasian brothers and sisters. And you have to say, you scratch your head and say, wait, really? Or maybe it's just Deborah. Maybe that has been only my experience where Let me just share this with you real quick. In a meeting that I attended, there was, you know, question about, well, at this one particular school, why are there more people of color getting scholarships than, you know, our own? And our own are leaving because they're not getting the scholarships. And when someone took issue with that, that person that took issue, that person of color that took issue with the comment that came from a Caucasian said, I have a problem with what you're saying. Just, can you just tell me what you're saying? What are you trying to say here? Because I want to be clear when I leave this meeting that I understood what you said. And the person said to him, well, before I tell you that, where did you come from? And he said, where did I come from? I live over here in this town. And he said, no, where'd you come from before that? And so he said, well, I graduated from Andrews and I pastored for a while. And he said, yeah, but when did you get out of jail? When did you get out of jail? I cannot tell you what a turn that meeting took. I cannot tell you how many people came to that man's defense for having said that to a person of color, and what conversations ensued, and what emotions were evoked as a result of that, and how, as an organization, people had to sit down and take a good look at themselves. And I just wonder, are we all ready to take a good look at ourselves? And how do we deal with some of those things? And I know our time is getting short. So that was probably more of a rhetorical question, because my next question is going to be, where do we go from here? That's always the question when you have these kinds of discussions. Where do you go from here? I see in the chat, are we waiting for a leader, a Black Christian leader, a Moses, to lead us out of this racial chaos? And that's a good question. And this is something I would like for everybody to contemplate and think about for a moment. Who in our church now are the Miles Martins, the Frank Hales, the Mr. and Mrs. Scott? Who are they? Do they exist? Do we need them? And what would their role be? Because they were the leaders of the grassroots effort. Do we have enough grasshoppers to be a part of an effort like this now? Anybody can take that. And you know what? If you don't have an answer yet, it might be worth contemplating to think about in our next episode, because we're going to continue this conversation. We have several of these conversations coming up. The Conscious and Justice Council is going to be putting on, and each of you is invited back to talk about that. But really, that's something that we should think about, and perhaps that will be the topic of our next discussion.
Deborah,
yes,
a couple of weeks ago, I just did this random survey of two questions asking, when was the first time you remember hearing Lift Every Voice and Sing? And number two, how does it make you feel? And I had a 22-year-old say that the first time he heard it was 20 years was when he was 20, and that it didn't make him feel anything. And I said, what do you mean it doesn't make you feel anything? And he said, well, it doesn't. And I said, do you know the words? And he said, no. And I said, therein lies the problem. I said, the song is replete with references to our history, as well as a call for resilience going forward. I said, and I would challenge you to listen to the song, listen and carefully consider the words. I teach an HBCU, obviously, where it's difficult to get students to even stand when the song is played. It's difficult to get students to even sing it when the words are on the screen, seeing as how they don't know the words. Okay. My generation has dropped the ball such that generation that I'm teaching don't know it, don't understand its significance. And so as we're looking for leaders to emerge from this generation, we have to also apologize and ask for forgiveness for that which we did not do when we thought we had overcome.
I'm looking at some of these interesting comments in here in the chat, and they're moving rather quickly, so I can't get them. I don't know if you all were seeing them, but here's as Christians, shouldn't we see it both ways? Deborah just said, our Caucasian brothers and sisters, should we judge ourselves as harshly when we stereotype white people? If so, it helps us look inward. Comments.
I think sometimes I think the reason why we focus on one group or another is seeing who's impacted, who's in positions of power and influence, and those who are recipients of the greatest disenfranchisement. When we talk about what we saw on January 6th, for example, you know, racism has been around for so long. But the reason why I think January 6th hit a different chord is because, one, where we are or where supposedly we have come as a nation over time. But this was an attack fueled and incited by some of the great leaders at the top. And I think it's important for us to understand the importance of words, the importance of narratives and repeated narratives. We have never seen any kind of storming of the Capitol. We have never seen those halls infiltrate the way that we saw on January 6th in the history of this country. We have never seen such a weak response from leadership and our police force ever before. And for many of us in my generation and others, we have not seen a display of racism in that way. That was a great display of contradiction and failure of leadership. And we have to remember, there is a group of Black Adventists, but we are also a global church. And whoever is sitting in positions of leadership, we need to have expectations of our leaders. Mm-hmm. We need to have expectations of the voices that they have. Mm-hmm. Folks who get a microphone, the folks who are in positions of power, we need to be able to have greater expectations for whoever that is, whatever color they are. So when we see racism, when we see these kinds of controversial actions, we really should be able to demand of our leaders better. And we have to be able to recognize false narratives, call them out, and call them out every time. When we say, I have an issue now even saying, you know, the white supremacists did X, Y, and Z, or first giving a qualifier of maybe folks with a notion of white supremacy, mm-hmm. folks with this false idea of white supremacy, because it's not true. That is not a reality in fact. And also talk about Christianity, Christian nationalism, for example. Everything done in the name of Christ is not Christian.
Absolutely.
We have to call that out. Yeah. And we have to call it out consistently. Yeah. So we need folks who are going to demand of our leaders better. We need folks at the top, the voices, to speak better and to speak truth. And truth is over culture, norms, and comfort zones. Everybody needs to do better, Black, white, and otherwise, when it comes to our Christian principles.
Right. And it's not just our leaders. It is the grassroots. We have to speak right. up so that they know that we are requiring, we are expecting, we are demanding that they speak up. And when they don't, we can sit back, we can get on social media and we can criticize and we can point fingers. But if we aren't doing something, then we have to point that finger back at us. So just as the Hales and the Scotts and the Martins did something in the 60s, we have to do something today. I want to get some final thoughts from you before we go. Dr. Kwesi, let's start with you.
Is the reflection to be whether or not we need an LLC in 2021?
Yes.
I think it's a very important movement that needs to be a part of our reality. And I have some students who are truly amazing and who give me hope for the future in terms of leadership. So I do think a lay movement And again, as Dr. Baker stated, at the General Conference in 1962, there were 100 Black pastors who marched in support of the LLC, even though they were not a part of the LLC. And that took a tremendous amount of courage to do that. And so it is not something that should be lay people only. I think that there's a role for each group of people to be represented in a 2021 LLC. And it is conference.
So, Erica, what would you see the issue perhaps be taking up in 2021 from the LLC? What issues would we be addressing?
With the church. Two things. I would like to see this church embrace gays and lesbians. We still seem to have a problem, you know, with people coming into the church. To me, the racism, I don't know really how we, you know, get this done. I really don't. But I would like those two things to be addressed, I think. You know, I learned something years ago. My brother passed away in San Francisco. And I saw so many people, you know, who parents push them out, things like this. And Christians demonstrating and so forth, you know, God-fearing people. But I keep asking them, are you serious? Do you really believe that if he were alive today, he would not be all up in this? You know, he was, how do I put it? He was not afraid. Not afraid at all. Not afraid of the leper. You know, if they were, you know, well, we know that. Oh, sorry.
Here you are.
Okay. I think I got it now. Sorry about that.
And oh, Jesus went out.
It bothers me. Can you all still hear me?
We can.
Okay. All right. Thank you. The church did start, okay, but they have not really finished it. Can I say that? You know,
there's more work.
We dropped the ball somewhere.
Yes, there's more work.
And these two things are very important today. You know, you see it all the time. It's around us. But yeah, I think those two things need to be addressed.
Those are
for real.
Okay. Those are two very
we have a way of bringing people into the church, and then we do such stuff, you know, they go right back out the door.
Right.
You understand what I'm trying to say?
Yes, I do. And thank you for that comment, Nicole.
For me, that's important. Okay. Very important.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Nicole. And I'm going to wrap it up with you, Dr. After Nicole. Nicole, does there need to be a layman's council now? And the issue of the LGBTQ community is one of the issues that should be addressed. Racism still an issue to be addressed. Mm-hmm. What do you think young people your age, what issues would you like to see this layman's council address?
If we had a layman's council, what I would like to hear more are some concerted efforts to have more conversations, intentional efforts to bring folks together and speak. Like Dr. Baker mentioned before, because we're so separate, we're just not around each other. So certain conversations that are never had. So there's a lot. If we grew up in these more segregated conferences, those are the conversations that we're having. That's the understanding we have. So I think our generations need to have a presented with some better understanding of the workings of the conference. I would like to see greater representation at these decision-making tables. But a lot of the young folks are just kind of removed from the inner workings of the conference at higher up. So how those decisions are even made or how we could even be a part of that is a bit of a mystery still. So I would like to see some very concentrated efforts to bring about greater education and involvement and some intentional efforts to bring outside groups together. Again, this is a global church. At least on our national level, we need to have more facilitated events, discussions, so that we can gain greater understanding. And I think it's only in that space where we can really get some traction and some change.
Thank you, Nicole.
Yeah.
Dr. Baker, let's wrap it up with you. So I think as I look in the comments, the question was, should there be a Layman's Council 2021? Yes. And we've seen a lot that said yes. And you say yes. Why? Yeah. And what would that look like in your eyes?
We need an LLC today, but I would say that in order to have an LLC today, we need to care. Mm-hmm. That's one of the things we may be missing. We don't care about the Adventist Church, I think, like Sister Erica and Dr. Kwesi's parents did. They were really committed. They were all in. I'm not sure we have that same buy-in with the church. Mm-hmm. I want to say a couple of points. Number one, I think to my brother's question, that as Blacks, are we checking ourselves? Because he mentioned that Sister Anderson said Caucasians, brothers and sisters, but do we give that same scrutiny to ourselves? Mm-hmm. You have to search your own heart. Are you discriminating? If you're a certain socioeconomic status, are you discriminating against those below you, those above you? If you're African-American, are you harboring something in your heart for our Caribbean brothers and sisters, our African brothers? Dr. Rock has also spoken about that, about a schism that sort of exists there. Mm-hmm. Do you have discriminatory thoughts toward white people? If you're a male, are you treating women as less than? These are all things that we should be constantly interrogating. Mm-hmm. Another thing that I noticed about the 43 committee and the LLC is that they were privileged Blacks. Check this out. The 43 committee, they were privileged Blacks. You had Valerie Justice Vance, who would get her PhD in a couple of years. Eva B. Dykes, who had a PhD. You name it. Addison Pinckney. They were privileged Blacks, as was the LLC, really working for those Blacks who were not as privileged as them. When I listened to Frank Hale's rhetoric, when I listened to Alma Scott's rhetoric, they weren't saying we're doing this for ourselves. They were saying we're doing this for, they didn't use the term, but less privileged Blacks who are being discriminated against. So they were making it better for others. Study Dr. Hale's life. Read Angels Watching Over Me. He said, I had a burden for Blacks who didn't have to get an education. And that's what his life was about. I mean, look at what he did at Ohio State University. They have a building named after him because he was seeking out Blacks who needed that educational opportunity, and he was bringing them up to that level. And so they were privileged Blacks who were really working for Blacks who had less. And so I would say that we should do the exact same thing. And Ellen White actually says this about Jesus. She said he didn't seek for his own personal rights. He sought for the rights of others. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't, you know, you should let yourself be trampled on. But if you look at these two committees, they were helping others. And that's what Dr. Hale did. When he had that privilege of having a PhD, having a certain position at Central State or Wilberforce or Ohio State University, he was bringing others up to that level, if you will. Mm-hmm. My last comment would be that I think it's time for Adventists to be prophetic again. you see what we say about ourselves, Revelation 12, 17, that we have the testimony of Jesus, Revelation 19, 10, the testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy. So this is not just Ellen White. We will be a people of prophecy. That means that we will be a people that look into the future and tell what's going to happen in the future, namely the three angels' messages and the second coming. But here we are with racial events happening in our church, and we are just as short-sighted and blind as anyone else. Things are coming and happening, and we're surprised by them. If you ask 10 Adventists, when is Jesus coming? You'll have 10 different answers. We don't know anything more than anyone else. And I think that our activism, our social justice activism, is as backwards as that. We are not even prophetic in that. So I think that we need to come together and have a unique brand of prophetic activism. And that is, we know from who we are, from our study of the Bible and spirit of prophecy, what's going to happen in the future. And we calibrate our activism for that, knowing what's going to happen. Jesus was big on this. Knowing what's going to happen, you do this. I think that we should have a more prophetic activism and a more prophetic ministry. So yesterday, we do need an LLC.
Thank you so much for your comments. And one of the things that you said at the beginning, Dr. Baker, was that we need to chronicle our history now, because we are history in the making. We need to chronicle our photos, our memory. We need to write things down. We need to journal. And we need to be a part of the history, because should Jesus not come before, we certainly do want our grandchildren to say, oh, but my grandparent made a difference. I need to do something. Something just came up in the comments that I really liked. We need to move from conversation to collaboration to cooperation and to community. And that's what this conversation is starting. So I would like to ask Ed Woods if he would come back on and join us. I want to thank you all for being with us this evening. It has been a pleasure. It is so nice to know that Nicole, who works on Capitol Hill, was not at on premises on the day of January 6th and is safe. But we know that you have an influence up there, Nicole, and just know that you have the prayers of the village, not just for your safety, but for your influence as well. And I keep saying this so many times, that we need more people. We need more African-Americans. We need more people of color. We need more Adventists. We need more Christians working in the political field. I'm going to say that until the day I die. Our influence should be heard in the places where policy is being made. So thank you, Erica Dutt. Thank you so much for being with us. Nicole, Ben, Ifeoma, Ed, thanks for bringing us all together. And this is a conversation that must not stop here. And I know that you already have some ideas about that. So thank you.
So thank you for the opportunity to speak to these issues.
Once again, on the behalf of the Conscience and Justice Council, wow, wow, wow. What a riveting, a rich, insightful conversation. Thanks so much for sharing your expertise and your experiences with us. The chats, the conversation has been overwhelming. Dr. Ifeoma Kwesi, thank you for getting well to share what you have to share, even though you might not be completely well. Thank you for your investment in time. Mm-hmm. Sister Erica Scott Wright, my new BFF in this Black SDA history movement, God bless you and thank you for what you are doing and continue to do. And thank you for being a voice in the Ohio area and speaking truth to power. God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Nicole Phillips, my cousin. Wow, what a rich speaking truth to power and keeping it 100. You don't care who it hurts. But thank you for letting our leadership know that we need to have an open and transparent process on how this church is run. And if you want to get us involved, we're not married to any of you. Tell us the truth and we can speak for ourselves, because some of the things that are going on doesn't make sense and we don't have to accept it just because you give it to us. I thought you were just brilliant. So thank you for being honest with us this evening. And Dr. Benjamin Baker, a scholar in his own right, you know, craving a spot for you and just speaking truth to power, had the privilege of being on the board when your dad was president at Oakwood, and you have set the bar and set your own standard and walked your path, obviously under the guidance of your parents. But kudos for just a very good presentation. People are asking Dr. Baker, can you put your presentation on your website? They want to be able to read it and digest it. So if you can post that to your website, they want to just have that. So if you can do that, we would greatly appreciate that on behalf of our listening audience. They just want to digest it and absorb it some more. Deborah Anderson, what can we say? When you get the best, you ask for the best, and the best delivers, it lets you know why the rest were not at the table. As she shared earlier, we will be having these quarterly presentations to discuss more whether or not we do need a layman's leadership conference and what that will look like in the future. So God bless each and every one of you. And thank you so much again for being a part of this broadcast. I was looking for Pastor Jerome Hurst, my partner in crime, the vice president, or I should say the vice chairman of the Conscience and Justice Council. And of course, you are motherland ready. What did you think of what you have heard tonight, Pastor Hurst?
Another riveting discussion, informational, inspirational, to just be able to hear some of the some of those who were there and saw it actually happen. I had the privilege in his later years before he moved away to Florida with his children to be the pastor of Brother Burl and Sister Bonnie Scott in Oberlin, and one of my earlier pastors. It was just a blessing to be able to sit and to talk to history. And I think the key thing that Dr. Baker ended with is that we have to care. It's not about, you know, while some of the catalysts for Brother Burl Scott and Dr. Hale was that their children were denied access to Mount Vernon, that was not the sole purpose and driving force, because their children were going to receive a good education, because as Dr. Baker said, they had somewhat of a privileged state, but they were thinking about me. They were thinking about the others who would come behind, that we should have an opportunity for education. Therefore, I respect them and try to do as much as we can. That's what the Conscience and Justice Council is all about. That's what we're trying to do. We are trying to make things better for our people, not us outside the church, but we're really trying to be a voice of conscience for the church as well. And so I thank you again. And just for all of our team who has helped put this together, this month has been awesome. And I think that those of you who have joined us, just continue to work with us and stay with us. We have other great things coming for you throughout the year.
Well, you know, the third Friday of every month, and you know, this has been a great Black History Month, you know, the PBS special, the Black Church, This Is Our Story, This Is Our Song, has been phenomenal, you know, in terms of really speaking about the role of the Black church. You know, I believe that the Black church is not only the consciousness of the state, but the Black church is also the consciousness of Christianity. And we need to weed out those who are traitors for self-interest, because they want something for themselves at the expense of other people. And it's doing a disservice to the committee, as Dr. Baker talked about in 1943, is doing a disservice to what was going on in 1961, where we have this me, fi, me attitude, and we have people in leadership who are actually traitors to the cause of justice and can no longer serve as a prophetic, a prophetic speaker, a prophetic voice as it relates to activism. And we have some, unfortunately, traitors in our midst who care more about themselves than they do about their Heavenly Father. And that is a sad state of affairs, where the Pharisees and the Sadducees look like us, and instead of helping the whole, they only care about themselves.
Yeah. Yes, where have the prophets gone? And that's a great challenge. We need to be more prophetic in our activism. And we have been active, but I like that, put me more prophetic. And that does call for calling out those who aren't toting the line correctly, but also is also pushing forward and continuing to push forward and searching your own heart and doing what all that you can to make things better.
Well, like you said again, and you highlighted it, because this is all happening in your conference. I mean, you said it very well. This Layman's Leadership Conference happened in your home conference of Allegheny West. So do not think for one minute that small, big things can't come from small conferences. Yeah. This Layman's Leadership Conference was birthed right there in Allegheny West. And it goes to show that little can become much when we place it in the master's hand. But what he said, and you highlighted it so well, Pastor Hurst, we have to care. And the state of apathy that is taking place in our churches should be an alarm for all of our leaders to be concerned and to make sustainable change, to make in terms of a paradigm shift as relates to our conferences. So, but we got to care.
One of the texts that I hold on to is found in Proverbs. It says, the righteous have a concern, or the righteous care for the poor, the less fortunate, the least of these. The unrighteous do not care. The unrighteous have no such concern. And so when we're measuring our righteousness, the Bible, the wise man in Proverbs says, measure it based on how much you care and how much concern you have for the least, the lost, and the left behind and the left out.
People are asking for Dr. Baker's website to get the presentation. Once again, blacksdahistory.org, blacksdahistory.org. If you want to learn more about the Conscience of Justice Council, visit our website, cjcouncil.org, cjcouncil.org. And if you want to keep up with our programming, next month, the third Friday of every month, the Conscience and Justice Council will have a program. Subscribe to the Conscience and Justice Council YouTube channel or Facebook page so you can see about upcoming broadcasts. Next month, we're going to talk about Black women and the church. Black women and the church. So no, it will not be limited to Seventh-day Adventists, but we will talk about Black women, Black and the Black church, our unsung heroes. Without further ado, Pastor Hurst, will you just close us out with prayer? And we look forward to tuning in with everyone. Once again, the third Friday, March 19th, for our next broadcast talking about Black women and the Black church.
Let us look to the Father. Father God, we first of all thank you for those who have come before us and have set an example of what it is to care for your people. Now, Father God, we pray. We have discussed, we have prayed. Now, Father, with changed hearts and empowered spirits, we ask, Father God, let us move our feet to action. Bless us until we meet again. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to welcome you back to life, back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift I left for me? To be free, it's amazing. With you, I win even if I lose. Everything's working.
Thank you.